We have some camels here that were booted from a beauty contest. So organize.
I saw this. Listen, listen.
Oh,
if you're giving your camel Botox, check, okay. If you've got money to waste on camel Botox, send me a check. That'd be a big check. Just 10% of the Botox Camel Fund.
This is Overtime, a live series brought to you by Rig Lynx and War Room Media, where we talk about basically anything we want. And here are your hosts, Greg Williams and Ryan Ray. Oh, back in there. Let's see. Ryan, how we doing?
Good, brother. Good. How you doing?
Oh, always good. Always good. So, let me look here. Ryan, did you know this is our kind of one-year anniversary here?
Is it really?
It is. It is. We did our first show on December the 14th last year.
Wow.
So, yeah. So, here we are, this 26 shows in. And I didn't even – I mean, I know you have, obviously, a full metal jacket worth of worth of shows in your arsenal. And it's I am like feeling super accomplished that I had 26 episodes worth of stuff actually to talk about.
Yeah. Yeah. So, you know, it's funny because I haven't done the math in a few months, but the last time I did it, I was over 600 podcasts I've done.
Wow.
Yeah, I know.
Is this okay? So this is just episodes, right?
Yeah, yeah, episodes.
And I'm gonna tell you, the downloads coming from Overtime just continuously just keep bombing in. I mean, it's just
great.
Yeah, it's not. It's more than obviously I would have ever thought would have come our way just through the variety of things that we talk about, because mm-hmm. it's not always business. Right. And so it, mm-hmm. there's some people out there like a mix of everything. So I'm glad we could kind of fall into that category a little bit.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
So with that year, anniversary, there's been a lot happened over that year.
Has there been?
I mean,
this past year, what you're talking about?
Hell, even since the last show, October 14th. So how things have been on your side, man?
Man, you know, it's good. Things are good. I can't complain. I'm actually coming down to Houston tonight, tomorrow, whatever. I drive down tonight. I'll be at the Africa Energy, the U.S. Africa Energy Forum. I'll be moderating a panel in Houston tomorrow at 9:30. So if anyone's down in Houston at that, I'll be there for a little bit. And then I fly out to California on Sunday, hopefully to close a big deal. So there's that.
Sweet.
And we'll see. You know how it is. You can't count your chickens before the eggs hatch. We ain't got chickens or eggs. We can see the hen house, and we're looking.
Well, we have some camels on here today. So yeah. So we do have that. But yeah, that's great, man. I'm glad to see everything's moving on your side. So for me, I've spent the last probably month and a half doing a rig reactivation project. So if anybody's ever done that, you know how fun that is. But it's plenty of work to do. It's challenging, but it's certainly fulfilling. But man, one of the things I wanted to talk about real quick before we got into the show was, it seems like I don't know what you're seeing on that side, but it seems like there's a lot of like deals happening here at the end of the year, like, you know, 5-year deals and 10-year deals for some of the service providers out there. It just, like, you know, the time of the year, kind of rare when you see this kind of, you know, you're out of budget. So, I mean, it's good to see all the forward progress, but man, where's all the money coming from?
Well, is there money actually coming, or is it just locking them in at low prices for a multitude of years?
Okay. So, but forecasted revenue is still forecasted revenue, low or high. It's still good. So
No. Right. So what I'm saying is, if you lock in someone now, you know, we've talked about on this show and other shows where the rates aren't where they should be, at least compared to historical prices. So if you're locking someone in 5 years right now with low rates, you're kind of getting a good deal, especially if the price stays high for the next 5 years.
obviously, without being privy to the contract, you wouldn't know if there was an price and increase over a period of time during the contract. So
that's it's possible. Well, think about
it. It's more possible on the contractor side, or especially the drilling contractor side, than there is probably the service provider. But
anyway. That's right. That's right. Yeah. Exactly. So
it's all in the ink.
Listen, I don't blame anyone right now for locking up, set revenue for the next 5 years. So I'm not saying that, because especially at the last 2 years, you take whatever you can get.
That is for sure. All right, let's get into the rundown here. Try to remember how to work the panel. It's been a while. Let's see. All right. So we'll talk about oil prices. That's Ryan's favorite conversation of the day. The Omicron effects and a little bit of price rebound. Biden taking the Fed green. Blue Origin delays Mr. Strahan's flight. A couple of other good things about that one, too. But WWE, we don't talk about wrestling much here, but we do talk about sports. So I figured I'd throw that one in there. But they rack up on some college recruits. And there's an 850-pound pot brownie there toward the end.
That's a big brownie, regardless of what's in it. Just to be clear, that's a big
brownie. That is a huge brownie. And some camels are getting disqualified from some beauty contest there in Saudi. So, without further delay, Ryan, we will get into the oil prices. So for crude, that looks like WTI, that's 71.82. And for the Brent, it's 75.26. API showed an inventory drop of over 3 million barrels, while I don't even know what to do with this, but anyway, it showed an inventory drop of 1.9. I checked out Big Orange Twitter yesterday, and he was saying that it looks like there's some destocking underway. Of course, Cushion had a build of 2.3 million. So, Ryan, you got anything to add here?
I mean,
is it destocking? Destocking.
Oh, gracious. What did Big Orange say?
Oh, he was saying it looked like the end of the year there was destocking taking place, and he had already said that, hey, looked at Cushing was already up 2.3, it was suspected. So he didn't go into a lot of he didn't allude to any kind of reason why it was the way it was. He just kind of said destocking. So,
The oil price, so we're up at 71.77 today on WTI. Brent's at 75.04. And if you go back and just pull up the 1 month chart and you look at it, we were up at WTI was up on November 9th. It was up to 84.15. And then went all the way down to 65.57. Now, that was because, in part, two things. One, it was kind of softening a little bit already. But then the Omicron, whatever, variant. I got a great meme. Can I give you a great meme on that?
Oh, always, man. Always, always.
This is going to be edgy. So if you for those of you who don't be triggered, let's tune out now. There's a meme out there that says, Alec Baldwin has killed more people than the Omicron.
that's edgy, but
it's factually true.
It is true. When you're speaking about Alec Baldwin, there was one I saw this morning where he was in the Pulp Fiction front seat, sitting in John Travolta's position, looking over across the back seat. And so, some of these memes are amazing. Some of them are just downright dirty, just as hard as you can get, just punch in the face. But I'm telling you, the chickens come home to roost, man.
Oh, I know.
This is and this is what people need to understand about, things that are said publicly and everything else, right? So,
Brutal. So, you know, the Omicron, anyways, the Omicron came out, major sell off, massive response. And then now we're not a month out from that, but we're out a couple of weeks. And now the news is like, well, maybe it wasn't that big of a deal, but now, yes, it is a big deal. And I just wonder how many more times oil is going to sell off on a variant news, right? So a new, because we got more variants that are coming. That's not controversial.
I mean, what were we selling it off before Omicron? I mean, we were selling it off on every other world event, so why wouldn't we not?
Well, consider, see, I don't think so. Mean, if you go back before, well, okay, but if you go back before COVID, I think most, except for when the Saudi refinery got bombed in 2019, most
oh, you mean with the drones that bounced off the tanks? I mean, but
other than that, that was really the only thing that kind of. So we killed, the U.S. killed an Iranian general, yes, and it didn't even really bump the prices. So the prices had kind of gotten news resistant, it felt like. Now they're kind of back into the swing mode. And so, you know, I don't
but
know.
But you yourself said for a solid 6-8 months into, so that would be 2021. Or no, it would have been the first 6 months we were doing the show that nothing would touch the price. Nothing was touching the price. It was just like, it was actually the opposite of what we were expecting it to be from the, you know, some announcements that were being made. But I agree on some extent about what has happened here is, of course, we were going to roll right into this Omicron chat here after the oil prices, but largely the world was expecting it to kind of derail economic growth, you know. So I was reading one of the statements from the UBS. It was one of the analysis, you know, on the oil demand kind of related fears were super pessimistic. So any kind of positive news was switching on the light there. Mm-hmm. So it's so hypersensitive that it just took a little bump and that was it.
Right. So, you know, I think the price was a little bit inflated. And, you know, we had Anas Alhaji on the Texas Gas podcast, and he said there's some hard break points. And for China, I think it's 75 Brent, and for the U.S., it's 85. And at those price points, you're going to see massive global responses to try to get the price back down. So, so how long can they continue to do that in the short term? Well, that's one thing. But I think that's something to watch is SPR releases or, you know, messaging changes as we get back up to that $75 price point.
Yeah, just whatever the next variant's going to be, hopefully it's a little lower than I don't even know. We skipped what was it? CDEF chats. We skipped a lot of lot of them in there. But all right, so roll straight into our next one here. So one of the things I like seeing on LinkedIn is always kind of David Blackman's, you know, commentaries on some of the different articles, especially the absurdities of the day. I appreciate his viewpoint is straight on, just gets straight to it, just cuts right in there, right? Mm-hmm. For me, this is another one of those kind of absurdities. So although we can't see the article, I'll just throw it up there real quick. But that's my free limit on the New York Times. I can't believe I ran out. Anyway, so this article is about Biden signing the executive thing yesterday to turn all purchases for federal used electricity by 2030 all have to be carbon free or purchased from a non-carbon dioxide emitting source. So first off, that's, you know, you're talking 2030. That's another presidency away, possibly another party change. Second, we've talked before about the work that's got to go into the grid, but the amount of just, the intensive labor and the materials and the things to change everything over to anything, even feeding, you know, all of these, and it goes into how many vehicles, how many buildings, how many things are powered. You know, or how much is being purchased from different sources that emit carbon dioxide and how much they've got to roll over. But if you just look at just a highway, for example, let's take 290 here in Houston. Okay, that's just a highway. Mm-hmm. That took 6 years, just that section through Houston.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
Okay, so now we're talking about rolling the complete federal government, and that's all federal. So that's it's everything in all of the U.S. that's federally managed and operated. They want to roll it over to non-carbon dioxide emitting sources in eight sure. years.
Yeah.
In eight years.
Not going to happen.
In 8 years.
Yeah. It's frustrating, Greg, because
it's not that I don't want people to use renewables and green energy. It has nothing to do with that, and nothing to do with it at all. Everything comes whenever it needs to come and gets into place. But the grandstanding, 8 years, you tell me 8 years, where's the plan for 8 years? Who's going to fund that? I mean, we will. That's where that comes from. So, I mean, what are we doing here?
Yeah. It's brutal. You make a couple great points there. One is, obviously, the federal government can't fund it, which means they're going to print money, which means which is a taxation on us, right? So that's a great insight there. It's a taxation on us, and obviously that disproportionately impacts lower income communities because now they're going to struggle more, which means potentially the government would subsidize more, which means, again, you've compounded the right. So you create a circular problem there. That's the first thing. Second thing to your point is these projects just aren't feasible. And so what happens is you build up this pent-up frustration. Well, why isn't this done? Why isn't this done? Why isn't this done? And you make more radical policy changes, and then you can't get those done. And so it's almost like a self-fulfilling negative prophecy, right? So, people talk about look yourself in the mirror and say
self-fulfilling negative prophecy.
Right. So people, all these gurus like, hey, if you look in the mirror and say I'm awesome, I feel great, I look great, you'll have better, self-image. And okay, whatever you think about that, that's fine. This is like the opposite of that. This is like, you see those people on, what's the show, American Idol or whatever, and they get out there and they can't sing, and all of their friends and family have never told them, hey, Ryan, you can't catch.
You can't sing.
Hey, Ryan, you can't sing. You can't dance either, so don't dance when you go on there. This is like that. This is like that. So everyone around.
You're saying there should have been an intervention somewhere in their life, and it was missed. The opportunity was missed.
Right, so what we're having is we put out, little Bobby, and Bobby's going to go out there and he's going to sing on American Idol, and everyone knows he's going to bomb, but they don't think he's going to get on TV. They don't think that. They think surely American Idol is going to
surely he'll never pass it through the audition.
Right. They're not going to pass him through to embarrass him on TV. But yet what happens is they put little Bobby in front of Simon Cowell and he eviscerates him. But little Bobby doesn't hear Simon. He goes, well, the first four judges passed me through, therefore I must be very good. And so little Bobby goes to America's Got Talent or whatever the other shows are. And so little Bobby lives in this dream world where he thinks that he's actually a good singer and dancer, despite the fact that everyone knows that he's not. That's what we're doing here. That's what we're doing here is we're continuing to perpetuate this myth.
But
we do these things and we can't.
But there's two sides, Ryan. There's the side where there's the, like you said, the perpetual myth. But there's also the other side of it where people are actually making money off the.
Oh, well, it's a racket.
Sadness part of it.
That's Simon Cowell, right? He's the one making money off of that.
It's the negative part of it that also sells as well. The memes and all the advertising and the marketing. I mean, yeah.
See, let me pull the curtain back here. I know someone who went to an American Idol tryout years ago. Really talented, really could sing really well. Now, I don't watch the show. Never really been. I've watched a handful of episodes, but not really into it. And so I didn't really realize how many people were trying out. But you would see the tryouts, and the good singers and the bad singers. So this girl, we're teenagers at the time, I guess. And so she went, and we're talking about it. And she, I think she said it's like three or four tryouts you have to go through before you get on the show to audition in front of Simon and Paula and Randy or whoever it was back then.
Right.
So you stop and you think about that. What that means is all those terrible singers are being put out there to be made fun of by the producers. So because she could really sing and dance and all this stuff, and she couldn't make it through the second round or first round. I can't remember. And so I remember hearing that, like, God, like that's really cruel and mean, is that you're putting people who you know are terrible on national TV just to mock them. Like that's mean. That's really mean. That's what's happening here. We're putting out policies that we know will fail, and we're lying to people, telling them we can pull them off, and we're fear-mongering. We're doing all of this stuff, and we know it won't work. It's mean. It's cruel.
It is cruel, and I like sometimes whenever, you know, it backfires on the judges sometimes whenever they do pull, because some of them fire back.
Right.
And especially live shows. We've seen, you'll see that in America's Got Talent from time to time. You'll see them where that something wasn't scripted or something like that. And then boom, there it goes right back at them. So, but it is, but you're right though. The perpetual myth there in the world living in this fantasy, or especially the shareholders and the investors, all they want is money back out of it. Mm-hmm. And, you know, they're not, certainly. But when you look at, we'll talk about this next one, this Blue Origin flight and everything else, you know, and the amount of money that's actually sitting on that flight. These are people that are also probably invested in green energy and renewable, but it's being supported by the wealthy. It's not anything else in this world. It's all being supported by the wealthy. It's a whole different ticket. So,
like I always say, until Bill Gates moves from his mansion on the beach of San Diego, the beach, which is going to be underwater, he says, to the middle of the country in Kansas, don't call me.
So, moving on to sports. We were talking about that just a minute ago, but Ryan, today, in fact, the Blue Origin was set to launch another flight, but it was delayed until Saturday due to high winds. The passengers for this flight are 6 people, 4 paying guests, Dylan Taylor, which is the CEO of Voyager Space Holdings, Evan Dick, which is an investor, Lane Bess, founder of Bess Ventures, and his son Cameron. Then there are 2 special guests, one of which is Laura Shepherd Churchley, daughter of astronaut Alan Shepherd, and former Giants and co-host of Good Morning America, Michael Strahan. The rocket is named the New Shepherd, comes 60 years after the pioneering NASA Mercury flight. So nice touch to have Alan's daughter on board. I'm sure that was, somebody's sitting in the background thinking up a pretty good marketing scheme there, but it's good. Ryan, the cost for one of the seats on the first flight, you know how much it was?
I'm gonna say $2 million.
Whew, you have to add on another $26 million to that. It was $28 million a seat for the first flight.
How many million a seat?
28 million.
Straight hands got $28 million laying around.
Look, this was there was only 4 paying guests. The other two, the Laura Shepherd Churchley and Strahan, there was no money out there for those guys.
Oh, okay. Okay.
The other 4, the Dylan Taylor, Evan Dick, Lane Bess, and Cameron Bess was all divvying up some cash. All paying.
That's a chunk.
Seats.
That's a chunk.
For a hop. It's over.
Yeah, I just don't see how this goes long term. I really just don't, but whatever.
Well, I mean, if anything else, they're looking to see, you know, what, you know, take for example Dylan Taylor and Evan Dick and Lambis. They're there looking for how they can leverage it, you know, and how they can use it. You know, in their sphere of influence, whether they can, you know, throw half a dozen, you know, fintech people in there and shoot them over to wherever in, you know, 15 minutes. And they're looking obviously how to use it for things that you and I can't afford. So,
Yeah, 28,000 would have kept me out. 2,800 would have kept me out. So,
I'm thinking if they could get it down to about the Burger King range, I'd probably be able to grab a seat. So
I don't know if I want a seat that bad, but yes, at that price.
That's bus ticket worthy.
That's right.
All right. WWE has picked up some college recruits here. So Vince McMahon picked up 15 college recruits for WWE NIL deals. I didn't know what NIL stood for. Did you, Ryan?
Mm-mm.
So there was 2 things there. I kind of looked around. I had to Google it, of course, but it's name, image, and likeness contracts.
Mm.
And the other one, well, which would be more, which would kind of fit. But the next one was next in line. So I would believe the name, image, and likeness contract before anything else. But but either of them are probably good. So my take here is, you know,
It's name, image, and likeness. Now that you put in that context, yes.
So these kind of contracts and things like that, extending past college for some of the athletes out there that don't go pro, especially kind of like the women's basketball side of it and the track and field and some of the wrestling things. Mm-hmm. So it gives a kind of another outlet there, but for anyone that's inclined to continue their athletic abilities past college. So of the 15 recruits, the Cavender twins, so that's Haley and Hannah, who play for Fresno State. They were part of the 15. AJ Ferrari, Oklahoma State wrestler. Carlos Aviles, Ohio State track and field. Lexi Gordon, Duke women's basketball team, and just a ton of other people there. But looks like they were ranging from basketball, wrestling, track and field, and football. So just kind of a round house of where they were pulling all the talent from. But after the NIL program, they could be offered exclusive WWE contracts. So I can appreciate the side hustle a little bit. So
does the WWE want to give us a name, image, and likeness deal? We're open.
Well,
what, you're not open?
Well, no, I'm certainly open, but what am I? We could do that. Name, image, and likeness. Yeah, we could.
They could make a little ride flash, a little fat guy, little figurine, you know,
with some little suspenders and shorts on.
I'm an early '90s WWE guy.
Me too.
I grew up, so you know, I can be the cartoon character.
I mean, I could be a bobblehead. I'm a bobblehead right now.
I'm definitely a bobblehead. I can be a. That could be like Bam Bam Bigelow's son, or you know,
Kevin Nash's sidekick.
Kevin Nash,
Little Nash.
Yeah, that's about right. Little Fat Nash, maybe. You know.
Oh man, but hey, look, this I think it's great that they even there's a program even out there for that. So, I mean, you don't think of WWE as a place that grabs up college recruits, but hey. You know, here you go.
What about podcast recruits? That's what we need, podcast recruits. Come on, WWE. Come on, Vince. Holler at your boy.
Just go sideline with that.
Yeah. Listen, we can do our podcast from their events.
Oh, absolutely.
And then they can show us one through the table while we're recording.
Oh!
Yeah.
We can make a huge – yeah, we could do great with that.
Oh, podcast. We can take it with the best of them. Come on.
We could actually do that with any wrestling event, not even WWE.
I know a wrestling promoter, you know.
Yeah, you know, I mean, even the Jell-O midget wrestling.
Wow.
You ever seen one of those?
I'm not doing that one. I'm not touching that one. I thought the Alec Baldwin joke was a little bit on the line here, but you've made me feel better, okay?
The Jell-O midget wrestling.
You made me feel better with that one. That's aggressive.
All right. We will now move over to our 850-pound pot brownie. Brownies, the brownies, and then there's brownies.
What's the ratio here of brownie to pot?
Okay, so this brownie weighs in at 850 pounds. It was created by a marijuana dispensary in Massachusetts. The name of the dispensary is called MaryMed. They're based in Norwood. They celebrated the launch of their brand or their new baked brand called Bubby's Baked. So it, I don't even know. The name's terrible, but it has 20,000 milligrams of TCH infused into the brownie.
That sounds like a lot.
It measures in at 3 foot long and 15 inches high. So. I'm not sure. You can imagine why they're all smiling very large here. Just not the, you know, it's not the 850 pound brownie there. They're probably testing the product as they're moving on. But they contacted Guinness Book of World Records as the current brownie own record is 234 pounds from a company in Alabama. But MaryMed was rejected.
Oh, no.
Because Guinness... Guinness doesn't recognize cannabis related records.
Oh.
Boom.
Oh.
So, Now, regardless what's in the brownie, it's still a brownie. So it's not like a record, like to see how much pot you could smoke in 24 hours. It's not like a, right. you know, see if you could smoke pot and like walk a tight line or anything. Like, it's a brownie, Guinness. It's a brownie. It's, I mean, they could have baked this brownie without a pot in it and it would have won the world record. But now it's had, because it's got some TCH in it, it can't be in the world record. Or can't even challenge the world record.
That's, yeah, whatever. That's nonsense.
It is crazy. It is crazy. They should have baked a 234 pound brownie with TCH in it, and then made one slightly larger without. So, but at the end of the day, Ryan, I would probably say that if MaryMed would have looked into the Guinness Book of World Records, they probably would have saw that ahead of time and probably not even called them. So that's a shame. That's a shame. Mm. That's a big brownie, bro.
That's a huge brownie.
That's a big brownie.
I mean,
and they're super happy of that brownie too.
Think about the vanilla ice cream you need to wash that down with. That's a tub. You need a couple tubs of vanilla ice cream to put that down.
So like a six pack of Lone Star. Wouldn't even make it through one corner of that.
No.
I like brownies too. I like brownies a lot, actually. Actually, I like anything. Actually, I just like food in general.
Yeah, we'll
just move on. Yeah, same. We have some camels here that were booted from a beauty contest. So
I saw this. Listen.
Oh,
if you're giving your camel Botox, check, okay. If you've got money to waste on camel Botox, send me a check. It'll be a big check. Just 10% of the Botox camel fund.
The organizers of the beauty contest for the camels, 43 of these humpback animals receive Botox treatments, facelifts, and other cosmetic procedures. Wait, it gets better. So you know what the prize for the winning camel was? And this may be some of the enhancement kind of behind the curtains here.
What?
The winning breeder was up for winning a purse of $66 million.
Whoa!
So
big business in the Botox camel. Good night. $66 million.
$66 million
for some camels.
The winning breeder. So
wow,
that's amazing, isn't it?
There's so much money out there just wasted on stuff. If you could skim,
I'm gonna highlight the thing here.
If you could skim,
so there's a highlight right there, yeah. Saudi Arabia. So, I mean,
$66 million for some camel breeding, unbelievable.
It's a camel festival.
Unbelievable! Wow,
month-long King Abdulaziz Camel Festival in northeast of Riyadh. So they actually. Let's see here. They put them through a official said advanced technology was used to screen the camels for artificial enhancements.
Jeez.
Advanced technology was used.
Jeez.
Wonder what advanced technology that was.
I don't even know if I want to know, to be honest.
This camel's lips are too big.
Golly, like
my goodness. No 66 million there for you guys. 43 unhappy breeders there.
That's crazy. That's crazy. 66 million. Unbelievable. Unbelievable.
I mean, is I would struggle understanding why you would have a camel in a beauty contest. First off, Not even the fact that the money was there. What are we doing with with these animals later? Like, are we using them for marketing?
Breeding them for something?
Do we have them carrying golden pagodas around on their back? I mean,
that's crazy.
Is it like the Clydesdales? You think like Budweiser used to have the Clydesdales? Yeah, I have like. Because I know there was Budweiser used to take care of these horses.
And oh, yeah.
That, I mean, these things were like the epitome of horses. I mean, they had basically their own house, you know, all of this stuff around them with all the personal trainers and the brushes and the foods and the big padded bed. And I mean, just all this stuff for them. Can I imagine that there's this house somewhere just full of these exotic camels sitting around, you know, hanging out, you know. Mm-hmm. I bet it's not inside of a pyramid or anything like that. I bet it's like gold plated stables that they're sitting in. And anyway, $66 million. That's a lot of money. So
that's a lot of money.
That is a lot of money.
Crazy.
Well, man, I think that's it for us this week. I think we end it with the camel Botox, man.
That's crazy. That's crazy.
So. Ryan, where are you going to be at again tomorrow? You said
the Africa Energy Summit, the U.S. Africa Energy Summit or Forum in Houston, Texas. So,
and you're going to be moderating.
Yeah, I'm moderating a panel at 9:30, I believe.
What's the panel on?
It is on. Hold please, I'll give you the formal title because if I get it is. It is titled. Africa as a global hub for strategic minerals and energy development.
They're right.
So I'll be there tomorrow at 9:30 to 10:30 at the U.S. Africa Energy Forum. Yeah. So it's at the C. Baldwin Hotel.
Gotcha. So anyone's out there going to be in that area, jump in there, stop by.
All right. Come on by.
All right, so I'm Greg with Riglinks, and that is Ryan with War Room Media. And thanks for joining us week for another edition of Overtime, and that's a wrap.
Talk soon, folks.
Absolutely. Have a good one.
You've been watching Overtime, a live series brought to you by Riglinks and War Room Media. Your hosts have been Greg Williams and Ryan Ray. For sponsorship opportunities, send us an email at info@riglinks.com. Tune in next Thursday at 10 a.m. CST for another live episode.